Tuxedo is a good thing to wear for weddings and stuff, amen. But that's about the only time I'm getting a hold of a bow tie, amen. I let the young guys wear the bow ties. They do a good job with it. It looks good on them, amen. I saw Dalton. Dalton, that looks right on you, man, amen. But like I'm 48. And I mean, you know, I mean, somebody said, preacher, you look cool. Look, I'm too old to be cool. You know, I'm just, you know. But I laugh. There's preachers in the day we live try to be cool. I'm serious. They wear their blue jeans. They put a shirt on about two sizes too small, you know, and remind you need that. Oh yeah, that's right. We're trying to save the whale. You know, you see that, you're like, what's wrong with them? Why are they doing that? You know, and then I'm gonna look like everybody. I'm gonna tear a hole in my blue jeans. I walk around the church tonight. I don't see anybody walking around with a bunch of holes in their britches tonight. Amen. I mean, if you got them, you know, it's not because you want them. You know, you ripped it on the car coming in here. Amen. But that's what we live. We think, well, I got to act like I'm 12 again so that I can, you know, be relevant to the crowd. Well, I just say this. This Bible is as relevant as you need to get. Amen. It's as up to date, praise God, as it's ever been. And there's no doubt about it. Hey, you don't have all that Bible is if you're, don't let somebody use those big words. It's antiquated. 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 Yeah, not amputated, Jack. It's it will amputate you. You better watch out. It can cut, amen. But I just say this. They say, well, that's old hat. No, brother, the Bible's, it's more up to date than the newest newspaper. And it can address the needs of every man, every woman, every boy, every girl. And there's no doubt about that, amen. If you need something from God, you can get it from the Word of God. And that's why we come to church. That's why we put ourselves under the preaching of the Word of God. That's why we obey the Lord when He deals with our heart and come down to an altar. I'm grateful that our church is an altar-going church. I don't want to take that for granted. Preachers come in and they're like, preacher, your people responded. I'm just like, well, yeah, I expect them to. Amen. I expect them to obey God when God touches their heart. And for them to come in, they say, man, that's not done everywhere. Well, the reason that's not done everywhere is he doesn't expect it. You know, if you preach about it and you expect it, then a lot of times people end up doing it. Amen. You teach them what an altar's for, then they learn they can go. They learn it's not a scary place to stay away from. They learn that, you don't just go to the altar when you got, some people think, well, I can't go to the altar, man. That means I've got wicked sin in my life. Well, it might mean that. You need to get it right if you do. But I just say this, on your end of it, when it comes to going to the altar, you find you can go to the altar and talk to God anytime you want to. And about any subject, let God touch your heart. It'll help you. And I believe that. Amen. I believe that. But I want you to look here. We've been dealing with marriage, with the home, with ministry, a lot of different things. I've been preaching on standing in the gap a lot. And I'm still got one more message to go on that. I'm not dealing with that tonight. But we preached on standing in the gap of our mission, which is reaching people that are going to hell. In other words, soul winning. We preached on standing in the gap of ministry and dealt with it several different ways as we preached on that. We preached on standing in the gap of marriage and how we need to certainly stand in that gap. Well, I'll be preaching sometime soon on standing in the gap of morality and how in this evil day we live, how, and with the morals the way they are, how that if God will help us, we don't have to live the way the world lives. And rather, the world is not our standard for what's right and wrong. It never has been. It never has been. The world is not our standard. We got to be careful too. I don't want to say, well, I'm as far up the world now as I was 20 years ago. Well, I hope not. The world's got a whole lot worse than the last 20 years. And if I'm as far from the world as I was 20 years ago, that means I've got worse too.
right.
I tell you, I want to separate from the world and be right in those areas, and pray that God help us with that. Amen. And more than ever before. But there's some things as you begin to look at the ministry. The Bible tells us in Corinthians about the house of Achaia that they addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. The early apostles, when they got the deacons, they said that we'll give ourselves to the word of God, you know, to that ministry, you understand, that ministry of the word. We have a ministry that God gives us. But more than a ministry, hey, we look at our manner of life, how we live. And I believe we can do that. Here's you another. It's not just your ministry and your manner of life. We include our marriage in that. And I guess, but when you begin to look at your Christian life, you begin to look at your home, you begin to look at your church, you begin to look at the ministry and what's happening, what you're going to see is there's some things that if they are included, now if they're in your ministry is going to be a success. If they're in your marriage is going to be a success. If they're in your daily life, your daily life will be a success for the Lord. And by the way, we look at success as measured by what God says in His Word and what God says is right. Now, we know the disciples were called disciples often when you begin to read. This matter of being a disciple is a good thing. You read through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Jesus called His disciples unto Him. A disciple is just a pupil, a student, you understand. Now, if you're saved, you ought to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you're saved, you are a disciple. Now, it's like being a student. Whether you're a good one or a bad one is totally up to you, you know. I mean, if you study and you're growing and you're a good disciple, you understand. But it's just like in school, you got kids that do good, you got kids that don't. And it's the same way in the church life. You got those that are growing, and it seems like in leaps and bounds and in striving to be what God wants them to be. And then you have those that struggle in different areas. It seems like they struggle in many areas. But what I see is this matter of discipleship. Brother, I believe God wants us to be a good disciple. Amen. Now, if you're going to be a good disciple, I can already tell you this. What are we going to have to learn? Y'all tell me. You have to learn the Word of God. You have to learn this Bible, amen. My Bible says in Timothy to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The Bible says in Psalms, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee, amen. In other words, the Lord wants us to dive into that word and learn the word and grow in the Lord and be what God would have us to be. How do you learn how to live? Read your Bible. What kind of Christian God wants you to be? You find it in the Word of God. Oh, what kind of daddy should I be? It's all right here. What kind of mama? It's all right here. What kind of son or daughter? It's all right here in the Word of God. What kind of church are we supposed to have? We find it in the Bible. Therefore, we need to be scriptural disciples. Scriptural disciples. Not only that, I think we ought to be a steadfast disciple. I think we ought to be somebody. Turn to Acts chapter 2 with me, if you will, by the way. Turn to Acts chapter 2. Notice, if you will, I want to give you just a couple of things here, because this matter of being steadfast, the Lord tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:58, but be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now, that's good. When you go to reading that, you think, oh my, I just ripped a page out of my Bible trying to turn it. Oh. All right, let me put it in the right place. Here, I'm going to put it right here. Y'all remind me, I'll have to put it back in there. Amen. This is my brittle Bible. It is. I mean, I knew that. I can't even underline stuff because it like rips when I underline it. This is an old Bible and the pages are a little dry. Amen. So pray for me. I didn't mean to rip my Bible. Y'all forgive me there. All right. But notice what the Bible says. I didn't rip the part I'm going to read. Thank you, Lord. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking of bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added unto the church daily such as should be saved. Now, when I read that, you know what I see right there? I see some steadfast disciples, amen. Daily they're meeting, daily they're reading, daily they're praying, daily they're doing these things. Can I help you tonight? If you're going to be a steadfast disciple, you better start reading your Bible every day, amen. You better get on your knees, not just once a day, but several times a day. You ought to start witnessing and telling people about Jesus several times a day. Now, look, we expect much out of a disciple, don't we? When you begin to look, you say, well, then man, as a disciple, then boy, there's things that God wants out of me. There's things that God needs out of me. Now, you realize that if we read over in Acts, I believe it is, chapter 11, turn over there. Turn over to Acts chapter, I'm going to be careful turning now. I thought when that thing ripped, I thought, you know, every once in a while I'm preaching, I'm like, well, if you don't believe that, just tear it out of your Bible. I'm like, well, oh man, I just tore something out of my Bible. Y'all pray for me. All right. In Acts chapter, it's chapter 11, maybe it's chapter 12. Let me look here. No, it is chapter 11. You see the early church and how Barnabas is sent over there at Antioch. And boy, I mean, there's a lot of good things going on over there. In verse 21, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came into the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem, and they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch, who when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave to the Lord. Man, these young Christians had gotten saved, and I tell you what he was telling them to do. Y'all need to be steadfast. You need to be cleaving to the Lord. You understand, you ought to be as close to God as you can get. I'm telling you, brother, what we need in the day we live is more Christians that'll cleave, amen. Hey, when we got married, me and Melissa, on our little cake, they had that verse on there that said, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife. Now, we ended up putting the whole verse on there because that's scriptural, and it was the cake was shaped like a Bible at our wedding. I mean, that was a nice cake. But I wanted to, I said, look, why don't we just paraphrase it, amen? Instead of putting the whole verse on there, we can just put on there, I'm leaving and I'm cleaving, praise God. Hey, you ought to do some cleaving. Somebody say amen. Now, if you're married, you ought to do some cleaving. Hallelujah. But if you're not, hey, if you're a child of God, you ought to do some cleaving to the Lord. That's what he told him to do right here. And he goes, oh, by the way, it talks about Barnabas, for he was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost and of faith. Much people was added unto the Lord. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. Boy, I tell you, what a good discipler right there. A man that said, boy, God's doing so many good things. I got to go get this man and put him over here and let him be a part of this. Now, I want to tell you something, y'all. There's people all around us that we need to get them in here. We need to let them be a part of this. We need to help them to grow in the Lord. Man, if they could be here and sit under this, they'd grow in the Lord. They'd get the help they needed. But hey, we've got to get them here and ask God to help us to do that. But he goes and gets Saul. When he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. It came to pass, I like this. Again, we're talking about being steadfast, that a whole year. Right. I said a whole year. The Bible says that they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. By the way, those disciples, because they were growing in the Lord, they were cleaving to the Lord. By the way, they were actively meeting together for one whole year. Imagine if we came for the next 365 days and met every single day around the Word of God, prayed together every single day, went out visiting together every single day. Imagine what God would be doing. No wonder much people would be added to the Lord. Brother, I tell you what else. Here's what happened because of that. The Bible says the last part of verse 26, and the disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. The first place you read in the Bible where they were branded as, look at those little Christ. Look at those people that, I mean, they act like Jesus. They talk like Jesus. What's going on? They're in the Word of God, man. Hey, did you know that when you get around somebody and they begin to talk about Jesus and talk about the Lord, you can tell if somebody's been anywhere near the Word of God just by hanging around them for a few minutes? You can get around them just a little while, and hey, do they talk more about the ball game than they do about the God? Did they talk more about some hobby or something like that than they do about the things of God? I'm telling you, your speech will betray what your mind and your heart is on. You see, right here, and the disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. It's the same thing that took place over here. Hey, go back with me, if you will, to chapter, is it chapter 5, I believe it is, maybe chapter 6. Let me see here. No, I'm sorry, chapter 4. Look with me in chapter 4 and verse 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. But notice what they did. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Let me tell you what your family needs to do when you get around them. They need to take knowledge that you've been with Jesus. Let me tell you, when you go to work tomorrow and the people that you work with, what they need to take knowledge of. You say, well, man, they're talking about this and talking about that. Are you talking about Jesus when you go over there to the house of God? I mean, when you go over there to the workplace, are you bringing up the Son of God? Are you talking about the Lord? You see, a child of God ought to turn any conversation towards Jesus when they get the opportunity. Otherwise, we're silent Christians sitting around a workplace while everybody, you say, and here, that's the person that says, well, I tell you, I sure do work in a bad place with a bunch of bad people. And man, they're always talking about something bad. Well, hey, why don't you bring up Jesus?
That's good. Amen.
Yep. Now, are you expecting them to bring up Jesus? Yeah, they might bring up the Lord, but you ain't going to like the way they bring up the Lord, I guarantee you. So I tell you this, you bring up the Lord. Hey, if they can talk about that wickedness, you can talk about Jesus. If they talk about their drunkenness, I'm going to talk about being spirit-filled. I mean it, son. Hey, they talk about the devil, I'm going to talk about God. They talk about their promiscuous life, I'm going to talk about loving my wife. Oh, yeah. You say, why would you do that? I'm going to bring the Son of God into it. I'm going to bring the Lord into it. Hey, you don't got to let the world push you around when it comes to being the Christian God wants you to be. I'm not talking about stopping the workplace. Hey, be wise with it. Sometimes there's a ditch on the other side of the road. Well, I got fired for witnessing to somebody. No, you got fired because you're lazy and you wouldn't work, and you blamed it on talking to people like Jesus. Right. Now say amen. Yeah. You know, I mean, you were supposed to be working, but you're like, and the Bible says, hey, if you're supposed to be working, then work. You know, I mean, yeah, you use your wisdom now. You got plenty of breaks. You got lunch times. You got break time and all these other things. Then give that time to the Lord like you ought to. But I just say, you realize that, hey, the Lord wants us to be a disciple, scriptural disciple, a steadfast disciple. But another, by the way, that's in your marriage. If you want your marriage to be a good marriage, then you be a good disciple of the Lord Jesus. I'm talking about a husband, a wife, being a good disciple of the Lord. I'm talking about a husband and wife. A good disciple's coming to Sunday school. A good disciple's going Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Why? Because they're wanting to be discipled. They're wanting to be discipled. Yes. If you're going to be a good disciple, you got to want to be discipled. If you don't want to be discipled, guess what? You won't be. Say amen now. There's no doubt about that. But if you want to be discipled, hey, the Lord will disciple you. I guarantee you. He'll help. The Lord will use his word. He'll use his people. He'll use his church to disciple you. But it's not just that. I want you to think about this. Think about the devotion that marks you as a Christian. That marks you, you understand, as a disciple. It's not just your discipleship. It's the devotion that you have. Right. Devotion to who? Devotion to the Lord. Devotion to his work, devotion to his word. Hey, devotion to worshiping God. I'm telling you, man, when I go to church, I'm worshiping God. And I'm not telling everybody, you certainly don't have to worship the way I do. And I understand that. Everybody's not going to say amen like I say it, but I'm saying amen. I'm just saying amen. If a preacher's preached, the heart of the preacher preaches. If he is on something real hard, I'm saying amen extra loud because I know he needs it right there. Amen. I know I am. You say, why? Because, man, that's how you encourage. That's how you encourage. By the way, that lets everybody else know right where you stand. Hey, let's everybody. Man, well, he's for it, isn't he? Well, amen. Well, that's the way it ought to be. But you understand, this matter of adoration, that's a matter of your heart. I preached on that this morning. I'll not hit all of that right now. But that matter of adoration is how you love and how you love the Lord. How you love the Lord's work. How you love the Lord's house. How you love the Lord's people. How you love the Lord's word. You understand, this matter of love or adoration, it covers a lot of things. But you want to be the Christian you ought to be. You want to be the disciple God wants you to be. Then your adoration will mark you. That devotion to the Lord will mark you as the Christian you ought to be. If it's not there, then we cannot be as close to God as we think we are, or as we're wanting to be. If we do not have that devotion. Now, let me ask you, if somebody is devoted to something, when you think about that, what do you picture? If somebody is devoted to hunting, what do you picture them doing? Man, they're not, you say, well, I picture them going hunting. No, if they're devoted to it, I mean, son, they're renting land. They're out there with tractors scraping stuff and planting crops when it's not even deer season. Right. Now, y'all get quiet. Just say, I mean, is that right? Is that what devoted hunters do? I know you guys, I'm not saying, I'm saying if you're devoted to it, that's what you do it. Well, if you're devoted to the Lord, then it's an all year occupation. Yeah. It's not just a Sunday occupation, this matter of being a disciple. Yeah. We get the idea that sometimes, well, I'm a good disciple because I showed up on Sunday. Man, hey, discipleship, being a good disciple, hey, there's a lot more to it than that. That devotion drives you to do a lot of things that the average Christian may not do. Here's you another, this matter of, it's not just devotion. How about, I tell you what else marks you. By the way, your devotion is another thing that marks a good marriage. I'm tying both of these two things in because you're going to see what I'm talking about in a minute. It marks your marriage when you're devoted to each other. You don't got to be around somebody long to see if they're devoted to each other. Man alive, sometimes you see a couple and they're against each other. Everything they got to say is negative about the other one. That doesn't sound like devotion. They want to tell you about everything the other one does wrong. That doesn't sound like a lot of devotion, you know. Love covers a multitude of sin. I mean, when you go to looking at devotion now, but hey, what about this? What about dedication, whether it be the Christian life or whether it be your marriage? Sounds like if you're the dedicated like you ought to be, then you're dedicating yourself to the Lord, to His work. Whatever it is God's called you to do, you're dedicated to it. Now, if you're in the bus ministry, you ought to be dedicated to the bus ministry. You ought to get up, hey, you ought to go ride out on Sunday morning. You ought to, number one, you ought to visit on Saturday. You ought to ride out on Sunday morning, ride out on Sunday afternoon. You know why? Because you're dedicated to it. If you're dedicated to another ministry, then you ought to be dedicated. If you're dedicated to the nursing home, then that means you're there every single Saturday or every Sunday or whatever day you go on. You know why? You're dedicated to that. If you're dedicated to the prison ministry, then you go when the Lord has opened that door. You're dedicated to that. You know why? Because you want to be faithful to what God has called you to do. So, oh, preacher, is it really that? Hey, if you're dedicated to a Sunday school class, you'll be there before 10 o'clock. You know why? Because the kids get there before 10 o'clock. Yep. You don't walk in at 10 o'clock and stroll in and thought, well, oh, yeah, hey, kids. No, get there early. By the way, you visit your class if you're a Sunday school teacher. Right. It's awful quiet. Amen. You know, and if you're a Sunday school teacher, then you're faithful to every service. Yeah. And if you're a Sunday school teacher, then you go visiting on Saturday when the whole church goes visiting. Good. Why? Because you're a Sunday school teacher. You're a leader. Now don't get all quiet on me now. Well, preacher, I tell you, we don't really care if we go visiting or we don't do any of that. Well, have y'all noticed by now? Now, we have a lot of people that go visiting on Saturday, and we have preachers that preach when I'm not here. Nobody preaches here that does not go visiting. Have y'all noticed that yet? Have you noticed it? Right. Oh, you hadn't noticed that. Well, that's why. If you're wondering why, I don't have never done that. I don't know. That's one reason. Why are y'all so quiet? Did you expect any less from that? Yay! I'm going to applaud and reward somebody that does not go visiting. You come up here and stand behind the pulpit, mouth this pulpit with the word of God, and proclaim how everybody needs to go visiting. No, man, you don't show up. You don't preach right here. Now, don't get all upset at me. I'm not the one that doesn't show up. Help me now. Hey, help me now. Well, I'll tell you, I don't like that. Well, I don't like you not showing up either. I don't like you not showing up. Hey, I'm talking about being dedicated to what you do. Dedicated to what you do. Well, I'll tell you, you don't know where I go. Hey, then love your church enough to show up when the church goes. Come on. Be an example to the other believers if you love your church the way you say you do. And then don't get all upset at me because I preach on what you don't do. Man, I wish I was some limp wrist preacher that just would preach. No, don't preach on what people don't do. I mean, because they might get upset. No, if you preach on it, what might happen is God might convict their heart. And God might deal with them in such a way that they say, you know what, that's right. That word of God teaches me to be dedicated to reaching the lost. And if I'm a leader, I want to be an example. See, my preacher preached on it, and I mean, it preached me under the pew. I mean, preach the devil out of me. You don't even understand that kind of preaching. I've never come in and stood people up in the service. My pastor stood me up one time and said, Brother Hopkins, you had anybody saved in the last month? You had anybody baptized in the last month? I just started weeping. I got out of my pew and I went down to an altar. He did that in a choir practice one time. I did the same thing. You say, why was he calling you out? Because he knew he could.
Right.
Because he knew that, hey, he was dealing with somebody. Here, look, if I hadn't had anybody saved and I hadn't had them back and I wasn't doing that, I mean, he loved me enough. I looked at it like that. The man loved me enough to preach to me. You can call it, well, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't stand for that. Then good. Go someplace where nobody preaches on anything you don't do. And you know, that'll be fine, won't it? Now, I'm on this matter of dedication. And I'm talking about leaders right now. So if you're sitting here, you're like, well, I'm glad I'm not a leader. Whoa, amen. Shout the victory, man. You know, I'm dealing with leaders. I'm talking about leaders. What's expected? Leader ought to be faithful to his church. If you're going to be a leader, then be faithful to your church. Be faithful. That's all.
Right.
I mean, show up. Don't lay out. Now, if you're serving, you're doing, I understand that. Please don't misunderstand me with that. I'm dealing with dedication. I'm dealing with the marks of a true disciple. And a real disciple is dedicated to the work of God. He's dedicated. Whatever it is you're doing, if it's that Sunday school class, you're dedicated to that class. If you work a bus route, you're dedicated to that bus. Have you noticed that? And by the way, you'll find that you find that somebody that's dedicated, they're not dedicated because somebody else is just expecting them to be. Their dedication comes from their devotion to the Lord that loved them and died for them on Calvary. I don't understand that. Well, let the Lord help you with your devotion, and then the dedication will automatically follow. Because devotion drives the dedication. It's not the other way around. Well, I'm going to get so dedicated, but I have no devotion to God. You won't last. You won't last. You'll spit and sputter. You'll do it for a little while. Then you'll quit. You'll come. Then you won't. Why? Because you're trying to put dedication before devotion. And you understand this matter of devotion. Hey, that love for the Lord drives everything you do and everything you are. You can't make yourself be something that you're not. Now, what God can do is God can change you. And by the way, that leads to, you know, when you get dedicated like that, you're doing it, then you're somebody that wants to fulfill your duty to the Lord.
Right.
You realize that there's certain things when you read the scripture that it's our duty to do these. It's God's word. God has laid this out, and it's an expectation that God has for you. We often just look and people say, well, preacher, what do you expect me to do if I'm going to do such and such or such and such? I say this, when I begin to read my Bible, oh, brother, there's so many expectations of duty that God has, that God says these are simple and these are modest expectations to the average, well, not even average Christian, but to a new believer. They look sometimes at these biblical expectations and it's unreal to them. I can't even grasp that. I can't get a hold of that. Why? Because they're I don't understand. They're young and growing up. But see, I'm talking about somebody tonight that's a disciple. I remember Nason, that is spelled M-N-A-S-O-N. Nason, the Bible says he was an old disciple. Now, I realize that could mean that age-wise he was physically old, but as I read that and study that, it sounds like he's been a disciple for a long time. Yes. Some of us have been disciples for a long time, and you understand, if you've been a disciple for a long time, then by now you ought to be to a place where your devotion has brought you to dedication, and that dedication, brings you to the, you got a dedication to a lot of things, but especially to God's word, and that dedication to the duty that God has, the things that God asks of us as a Christian, as a leader. When you begin to look at that duty, I tell you what, as you begin to do that, and you say, Lord, and by the way, see, now you're getting to a place, there's a time where you can do something out of excitement. There's a time where you do something out of thrill. There's a time where you do something because you're like, man, this is fun. But there's going to come a time where you have to get up and read your Bible, not because you're excited that day and not because it's fun that day, but because it's your duty. Because if you're going to get what you need from God, you've got to get in your Bible. If you're going to be strong in the Lord, you've got to get in your Bible. If you're going to wash and keep yourself clean from the filth of this world, then you've got to get in your Bible. I'd love to tell you that every day you wake up, you might wake up and be laughing. Bible time, amen, time to read. Maybe you're excited. You're like, whoa, man. Feel like you don't, you know, if you're a coffee drinker, you've done drank 12 cups of coffee. Like, man, give me my Bible, I'm ready to read my Bible right now, amen. And that's good if you're going to read your Bible like that. Read it. But I'm going to tell you something. You realize, wait a minute, it's like your marriage. I want it to be, I heard one husband, he told me one time, he said, well, I want my marriage, I want every day to be just like it was on the honeymoon. I'm like, ain't happening. It ain't happening. Well, why can't it be that way? Well, I preached this before, but children, work, job, responsibilities, a lot of things, yeah. And you understand? So, I'll tell you what, if it can't be like that, I don't know if I want to be married. Oh, so then you're not very devoted and not very dedicated. Here's what you're going to have to realize. There's things you do as a Christian. There's things you do on the job. There's things you do in your home. Sometimes you're not going to have the thrill of doing it. You're not going to have the excitement of doing it. You know why we do it? It's simply our duty. It's right. We know it's right. We know it's going to help us. We know it's going to be good for us. And we have to do it. We have to do it because we want to please God. We don't have to do it because it's right. It's just it's simple duty. But by the way, now you've gotten to a place that you're doing what you do because of your devotion to God. Now your dedication, brother, or your devotion leads to dedication. Your dedication leads you to even doing things when it's not fun to do it, exciting. You do it because it's your duty, because it's right. But now when you're doing it like that, you know what God begins to give you? Discernment. Discernment. Yes. Between what? Good and evil. What's right, yes, and what's wrong. You're not when the Bible speaks about, there's a man in the Bible, in the Proverbs, called the simple. You're not simple anymore. Everyone turn to Hebrews chapter 5. Let me help you with that. Go to Hebrews chapter 5. In Hebrews chapter 5, look at me in verse 11. Look with me in verse 11. Of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing ye are dull of hearing. For the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become as such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat believeth unto those that are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. You see, that strong meat, strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age. Their devotion is in place. Their dedication is in place. Their duty to the Lord is in place. And now what's happening is, and what you're seeing is, God has given them discernment. The Bible talks about the natural man, in Corinthians, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. Why? And he reminds us, for those things, the things of the Spirit of God, are spiritually discerned. See, this is not horse sense. This is not, well, I tell you what, man, I grew up and I know this and that, and I heard, and daddy taught me this, that, granddaddy. No. These things are spiritually, biblically discerned. How can you discern something if you don't know what the Bible says? How can we discern something how can we discern it to be scriptural or not if we're not basing it on what the scripture says? You see, that strong meat, there's milk, meat, strong meat. If you're on the milk, you know what? Praise God. Keep drinking the milk, man. Don't worry about the meat or the strong meat. Hey, you'll gag on that. And that's why I made it important a minute ago to say, hey, I'm dealing on leaders when you're dealing on expectations out of them. But out of somebody coming to church, joining this morning, Corey and Kristen. Where's Kristen? I saw, there they are. Amen. Corey and Kristen, join the church. Praise God. Man, I'm liking that. I'm enjoying that. I mean, they're just coming down there. They're like, oh man, that's right. We're the newest members of Heritage Baptist Church. Praise God. You know. By the way, the new hadn't wore off on them yet. Here, that them taking it for, they don't take it for granted. Everything is like, oh yeah, this is good. You know why? Because they're just excited. The Lord put them in here, man, and they just obeyed the Lord and joined the church. So they're thrilled and excited. But hey, milk, meat, strong meat, whatever God gives you, hey, you eat what you're able to eat. You know? I'm not, don't worry. They joined the church this morning. I tell you what I think I'll do. They may be assistant pastor next week. No. Not next week, brother. Hold on a little while. You know what? Grow a little while. Get strong in the Lord a little while. Let God help you to be what He wants you to be. Amen. Nothing wrong with that. Let Him put the things in your life He needs to put in there. Let Him get the things out He needs to get out. Let God work on all of that. Fine. Nothing wrong with milk. Nothing wrong with meat. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with somebody eating strong meat if they're able. Right. Now, but you understand, the Lord tells us that if you're one of those that are, He said, you ought to be a teacher. By now you ought to be devoted. By now you ought to be dedicated. By now you ought to be doing things because it's just your duty to do it. By now you do things because you've got good biblical discernment, spiritual discernment. And brother, when you get to that place, I mean, you're at a place now where, and by the way, isn't that the way it is? We flip that back over to marriage, but it's the same thing. You do things in your marriage, because it's right. It's your duty to do that, to be that, to be what you ought to be. God can put God can take excitement, and God can put the things like it needs to be into a marriage. There's no doubt about that. But we begin to do things because it's our duty to do it. By the way, there's a certain I jotted this word down just because when I think about the Christian being what he ought to be, when I think about the married man or woman being what they ought to be, there's certain dignity that God gives you. Dignity is not just some word that you get. I want to die with dignity. Now, that's not the only time you can use the word dignity. Now, I think we people want to have dignity, a certain respect, a certain, you know, I understand that dignity when it comes to the end of life. But I'm talking about in our spiritual life, I'm talking about the dignity to do what's right.
Right,
you know, personal respect, spiritual respect. It's a respect. See, to me, that dignity I'm talking about, we want the dignity personally when we get to a certain age when it comes to die. I'm talking about giving God the dignity He deserves.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the respect, the honor, the glory that He deserves. See, now you're a Christian that because of your devotion, which has led to being dedicated, which has led now to you doing things because it's right, because it's your duty to do it. Now you're getting down to a place where all of a sudden, now I want God to be glorified. You talk about dignity. You talk about, we talked about sometimes people that are, when an ambassador comes and they come to our ambassador goes to a foreign land and how they're treated with respect and how they're dealt with, or sometimes they're not. I just say this, the Bible tells me and you, we're ambassadors for Christ.
Yep.
Let me help you with what you are. You are a representative of Jesus Christ down here.
Yep.
You are His representative. Now, whether your personal growth, everything you do in your Christian life, whether you're a good ambassador or a poor ambassador, it's up to me and you. It's not up to anybody else. Your personal wife, it's not up to your husband if you're a good ambassador for Christ. It's not up to a husband if his wife is. It's not up to the parents if the kids are, the kids are if the parents. It's none of that. It's not up to a church people if their pastor is, or a pastor if their church is. You understand this matter of being an ambassador, realize I am His representative. And that right there drives you, or it ought to drive us, to be what God wants us to be. Now, here, those are all the right things we need in our life. If I was going to, you're dealing with the church, then that's one thing. I guess some of the same things you can deal with marriage too. I didn't even get into all the enemies of the enemies of our ministry, of our discipleship. Deception, doubt, division, discord, defilement, sin in our life, all of those things. In a marriage, here's some things that can really, it can mess you up. Some of the enemies of your marriage, debt. Oh man, debt can mess a family up. Debate, arguing over stuff you don't need to argue about. The same way that debate brings on disputations, you understand. And then when it gets like that, people get defensive. Man, that can mess up a marriage when everybody's defensive. Yeah. When somebody departs, they decide, well, I'm getting out of here. That's not good. Separating is not good. Here's another, divorce. Divorce is not good. You say, well, preacher, you mean Satan? Well, he'd love to use any of that he can use against your marriage you have right now. He'd love to use any of that he can against your ministry, against this church that he could. I'm not even going to preach on all of those. That'd be a lot of things to deal with, and it's just not feasibly timed, to deal with it in the right way. After a certain time, people quit listening. Some of y'all quit listening when I hit on visitation a little while ago. So, I understand. Amen. But I know this. I know without a shadow of a doubt. I'm going to preach this way because I want us to grow in the Lord. I wish tonight you would say, isn't it funny how somebody gets hung up on one thing the preacher says, when instead, I wish you could have majored on that matter of being devoted to Jesus and said, Lord, is that what you're speaking to me about? Do I need to be more devoted to you? Lord, do I need to be more dedicated to you? Lord, is that it? Are there areas where my dedication is not what it needs to be? And God, I want it to please you. Lord, are the things that I just need to be doing because it's right to do. Lord, this matter of discernment, God, do I really have good discernment of good and evil? What's right and what's wrong? Let me help all you teenagers. Teenagers, you don't have good discernment. Who has better discernment than you? Your mom and daddy. Say amen, kids. Hey, mom and daddy's got a whole lot more discernment than you have. They don't understand. They don't have to understand. They got better discernment than you have.
Right.
No still means no. Don't do that means don't do that. And they got a reason. You say, well, they didn't give me a reason. They don't got to give you a reason. That's your parents.
Yep.
It's right because they told you to do it. It's right because they're your parents. That's your authority in your life. And you do not have the discernment to know what you ought to do right now. Right. I'll tell you what, man, I've got the discernment. I know what I ought to do. No, you don't. I tell you, I can biblically tell you some things you don't need to do, you know, and some things that you do need to do. But I tell you this, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. That it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live long on the earth. Don't cut your life short because you're rebellious to your mom and daddy. Say amen. Now, hey, come on now. You know, don't fall in some early grave because you're deciding to buck mom and daddy. And I tell you what, I'm going against them. I don't care what they say. Your parents tell you to you can talk on the phone. Good, talk on it. When they tell you not to, don't talk on it. They tell you you don't watch something, good, watch it. If they tell you not to, don't watch it. If they tell you get on the internet, good, get on it. If they tell you not to, don't get on it. They tell you you can talk to somebody, talk to them. If they tell you you can't, then don't. They tell you how long you can talk, good. Just talk as long as you're supposed to. Don't get around that. Don't talk longer than that. Don't get under your covers and be on your phone or be on some game until 3 o'clock in the morning. That ain't right. It ain't right. It ain't right. Does mom and daddy know you're in there doing that? No, I'm just helping the young people. Amen. You young people go to liking somebody. You know, why don't you talk? You know who I talked to about it? I talked to my parents about Melissa, and I talked to my preacher about Melissa before I ever started liking her. Why? Because I didn't trust my discernment. I'd like, well, I don't know. She's pretty. I mean, that was enough for me. Good looking. Lord, that's the only qualification I need. Amen. There it is. You know. Now, I'm glad I went to my pastor and he said, no, she knows the Lord, number one. She loves the Lord. She's dedicated to the Lord. I said, Brother Terrell, you can prayerfully pursue that. I think that'd be good. That was my pastor. And then parents, you know, they were in church at that time and stuff, and I went in there like, oh, she seems like a good girl. But you know what? I didn't know it. They went and talked to my pastor too. The parents went and talked to my preacher. My parents went and talked to my preacher and said, you know, Terrell's thinking about this. And the preacher said, yeah, he's already come to me. And he said, I was going to talk to y'all, figure it anyway, just so that y'all know about it. But he said, in other words, they all got together and talked about it. Isn't that a strange concept? Well, I don't know. I don't need my mom and daddy. I don't need their approval. You need their approval. Somebody ought to have veto power in your life, teenager. And I tell you, it ought to be. If mom and daddy, if for whatever reason they don't have a good feeling, here's what you got. Some boy, he can smooze mama, but he can't smooze daddy. Because daddy's already skeptical about him. Daddy's like, hey, son, I'll bury you out there with the rest of them. And I don't care. I go to jail. I don't care. You know? And you know what? He don't. But hey, mama, now that girl, she'll smooze daddy. That girl that likes your son can be like, oh, you know, David. Now I'm using David now. I didn't use that because that's my son. I'm sorry, Brittany. She hadn't done that. She hadn't done that yet. But the girl can smooze daddy because they'll think, oh, daddy, you know, because she'll say nice things. Daddy's like, I think that's a good girl. Mama, then mamas, they got them snake eyes. And then mamas, they're like, that girl's a hussy. That girl ain't no good. That girl, something's wrong. So if I can feel it, I'm like spider senses tingling, you know. Oh, man, I did it again. I broke one a little while ago when the choir came down. I'm sorry. You know why? Mom and daddy, hey, the Lord gives you mom and dad a little bit of discernment. Amen. Kids, listen up. Discernment. Your mom and dad's got that. Your pastor's got that. Yeah. You got people that's got, don't go, hey, well, I don't want to go to any of them. Here's what you do. I'm going to go to my friends. Yeah. Hey, y'all. Hey, peers. Guys that have as much trouble as I do, you know, guys that are messed up as much as I am. Hey, what do y'all think about it? Yeah, you know, it's good. You do it. I think it'll be good. Yeah. You know, thanks, fellas. That's what I was looking for. Somebody to agree with me.
Yeah, that's right.
Because Lord help if you have a friend that loves you enough to say, hey, that ain't right.
Right.
Because then you're like, I'm going to unfriend you. You're not my friend anymore. You know, you're not my BFF, my big fat friend. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that. But you understand, hey, little discernment. I'm sorry, I want to throw something in for the single people, amen. The young people. Look, do you want to be a good disciple for your Savior? How's your devotion? How's your dedication? Do you do things because it's just simply the right thing to do? It's the biblical duty to do it. How's that discernment? Man, I'm having a hard time with that, preacher. I need the Lord to help me with that. Then let's work on that devotion, the dedication, and the duty. When you're in this Bible every single day of your life, and you never miss a day, and you're on your knees several times every day of your life, because it's right, because you love Him, because you're dedicated to it, the Lord begins to give you a little spiritual wisdom, a little spiritual discernment. Not so we can walk around, I can spiritually discern things. Well, I think if you ever say that, then your pride just cast out your discernment. But where you say, Lord, by your grace, I have no... Here's my statement to the Lord often, just about every time I pray. Lord, I do not have the wisdom to pastor this church. I do not have it on my own. Without you, God. The Bible says, if any man, I'll quote that verse. Lord, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally. I'm telling you, every time I'm praying about pastoring this church, it's, Lord, I do not have the wisdom without you helping me and giving it to me. When it comes to my family, being the daddy, the husband, the father, it's, Lord, I don't have the wisdom on my own to raise this family and to help my children be what they ought to be, and to help my wife. I don't have it. But Lord, you said if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, which giveth to all men liberally. Don't you believe if you ask God for it, that He'd give it to you? Then maybe here's where we're at tonight. He's standing here with it, and He's willing to give it to you if you'll ask Him for it.